Hello viewers, and welcome to a new episode where we will be discussing about information. Now, information is a very important part of our daily lives. It is all around us. And if we think about it, which information we grasp and which ones we ignore kind of depends on various factors. One of these factors is going to be our topic of discussion today. It is called the selective processes. And to discuss about this topic, we have with us today Ms. Sushmita Pandit, who is an assistant professor in the Department of Media Studies at the Future Institute of Engineering and Management. Hello, ma'am.
Hello. Hello, viewers.
I am Shantan Mukherjee, a student of Media Science. So tell us, ma'am, what is this selective process all about?
Yes, we are going to venture into the selective processes, but before we move to that, to understanding what the selective processes are all about, we need to understand what perception is all about.
Okay.
Because perception plays an important role, and perception actually by nature is very selective. So if we look into what perceptions actually do to a particular individual, we will actually see that it actually influences a particular individual in various ways. And it helps that particular individual to choose what particular message he is going to grasp.
Okay.
So we actually see that perceptions have two different aspects. One are the physical aspects and the second are the psychological factors.
Okay.
So physical aspects of perception basically relate to, you know, like having, like if you look at dots, then you will actually get to understand that it forms a line. So when you look at dots, if the dots are, you know, dots are
arranged,
arranged in a proper order, then it appears that it is a line.
Okay.
So that is the physical aspect of perception.
Mm.
The second, which is the psychological factor, it's basically related to subjectivity. And today what we are going to discuss is more about subjectivity in a message and how subjectivity plays an important role in making a particular person understand a particular message.
Okay.
So that is what we are going to talk about. And regarding the selective processes, we are going to move there. But we have to understand one more thing, that is the selective processes are influenced by the cultural expectations, needs, moods and attitudes of a particular individual.
Okay.
So what happens is that when you are actually selecting a particular message or when you are retaining a particular message, you are doing so based on some preconceived notions or based on some particular kind of belief system. So the belief system is an important part and it plays an important role in the selective processes. And one more important part is that of the cognitive ability of an individual.
What is the cognitive ability, ma'am?
The cognitive ability is basically, you know, retaining a particular information. Cognition is the process of retaining a particular information and understanding a particular information in a proper way.
Okay.
So which information you are going to retain, which information you are going to give importance to, that is what cognition is all about.
Okay.
So the imprints which form in our brain, that is something which is cognition. In short, we can say that, you know, this entire processes related to selectivity depends on a particular theory which was actually formulated by an individual called Leon Festinger. The name of his theory was the cognitive dissonance theory.
Okay,
as the name suggests, that cognitive dissonance theory actually talks about how cognition, how a particular particular person's belief system actually plays an important role in rejecting a particular message. That is what, you know, Leon Festinger had tried to focus his discussion on. But it is not only Leon Festinger who has used the selective processes to discuss his concepts on cognitive dissonance, but also other scholars and theorists, they have from time to time tried to formulate their own understanding of the selective processes too.
Okay.
So what we have to understand is that all these theories related to the selective processes form a part of the attitude change theory. People and scholars and researchers, they have from time to time tried to understand how attitude and behavioral changes occur in a particular person. The psychological effects of communication or the psychological effects through which a particular person is willing to change his conception of about a particular thing. This is something which has concerned our researchers, you know, for many years. And it is still going on today. So it is an important part of the psychological understanding of how actually communication or message plays an important role for a particular individual.
I see.
Okay. Mm. So moving on, if we try to understand this particular understanding of the selective processes, we need to also keep in mind another important factor, that is the cognitive consistency. So cognitive consistency, basically, as you can see here in this particular quote, it's a tendency to maintain or to return to a state of cognitive balance. And this tendency towards equilibrium determines the kind of persuasive communication to which the individual may be receptive. So actually, what we see is a particular kind of consistency is very essential if you want your communication process to be successful.
Okay.
And it is here that, you know, mass communication plays an important role. Because, as you know, the mass communication is a kind of communication which is very, which is kind of, you know, formal in nature, and it, it actually, a particular communicator is talking to so many people. So it is very difficult for the other people also to grasp that particular message. So how can you make the other other person aware of a particular thing which the communicator is trying to put forward to? How can that particular person understand it, grasp it in a way which actually suits the purpose of the mass communicator? That is very important. And that is something where you can actually understand this, how this theory is related to mass communication. So we actually see that different theories, even Lazarsfeld, Melvin de Fleur, all these theories have also been concerned about the aspect of cognitive consistency in a message. So some kind of a balance is very important. Balance in the sense, because each and every person is not going to interpret the message in the way I want it to be interpreted. But actually, we should try to make a particular kind of effort at least, so that the other person actually tries to grasp some part of our message. He can actually grasp it. So in that aspect, we will be successful. So that's why cognitive consistency has been the headache of the researchers. They wanted to understand how this can be done, how a proper equilibrium and balance can be maintained, so that, you know, the communication process becomes easier. So this has been thinking of the researchers from the, from, you know, time, eternal time. It is, it is still going on.
But ma'am, if what information we grasp and what we ignore, do we do this consciously or does this happen subconsciously?
Actually, actually we can do, both the factors play an important part. Sometimes we don't understand why we are ignoring a particular information, but we are doing it because there are some aspects in our daily life, or there are some value system which is so strong in us that we are actually subconsciously somewhere, we are actually ignoring a particular fact. It can happen consciously. You can yourself try not to watch a particular program, maybe because you know that this program actually speaks about certain things which you, which are not consistent with your thoughts. And secondly, it can also happen subconsciously because you are not aware, you're watching a program, but somehow you're you know, making yourself aware of the fact ki, no, these are all, you know, these are all wrong information, I don't believe in this kind of stuff. So that way you're doing it consciously, but both the factors play an important play an important part in understanding a particular message. As I said, that in order to understand these processes, we have to understand Leon Festinger's formulation about cognitive dissonance. So when actually Leon Festinger had given out or tried to explain his theory of cognitive dissonance, he had he had himself given certain examples also. And as we can see, we can see his quote, which is very important. If a person knows various things that are not psychologically consistent with one another, mm-hmm. he will, in a variety of ways, try to make them more consistent.
Okay, for his ease of understanding.
Yeah, okay. So he will try to make it consistent. Mm. Okay, suppose for example, as we can take the example of smoking.
Yes.
Okay, we know that smoking is not good for health.
Mm.
It's injurious to health.
Mm.
But does that mean that the people who smoke on a regular basis, they have not totally left smoking? You will see that they actually see so many different kinds of messages that smoking causes cancer and you have to leave smoking. They understand that it is harmful for them. But somewhere, you know, they are not ready to believe it, because if they believe in that particular system, then they have to quit smoking.
Yes.
So actually they form a particular kind of, you know, balance between the message and their understanding.
The pros and cons.
Yeah, like for example, they might think that, you know, if people are to die, if you ask some smoker,
he will say that,
you know, people are going to die one day. So what's the big deal?
Okay.
So even if I smoke, then also I'll die. So let me smoke and die. Okay. So these are, you know, kind of, you know, vague kind of, what should I say, vague kind of proof which they are attaching to their own belief. Right? Because they actually don't want to quit smoking. So they are actually giving some kind of a, they are providing some kind of a material so that it can stand strong on their understanding, on their belief point.
Okay.
See, in this way, they are having, forming a kind of consistency with the message which is being circulated. So actually, when you see a particular message which is not consistent with your thoughts or cognitive ability, you're going to have a kind of psychological discomfort. So that's why information which is not consistent with already held values or beliefs actually creates some kind of a psychological discomfort. Okay. This is also which Leon Festinger had continuously proved in his theory itself. So from, as I said, that from cognitive dissonance theory itself comes the selective processes. So if we try to understand the selective processes, we also need to understand another theorist, Joseph Clapper. Now, Joseph Clapper also actually, in trying to understand this cognitive consistency and this cognitive problem, he also tried to, you know, understand the model based on Leon Festinger's assumptions.
Okay.
And he actually said people tend to expose themselves to those mass communications that are in accordance with their existing attitudes and interests. Consciously or unconsciously, they avoid communications of the opposite hue. In the event of their being nevertheless exposed to unsympathetic material, they often seem not to perceive it or to recast and interpret it to fit their existing views, or to forget it more readily than they forget sympathetic material. Now, this is something, in short, he has explained, and this is something which the selective processes actually deal with. The selective processes in itself are very complex when we try to understand it. And as we said during the beginning itself, that the cultural factors and the value system, the belief system actually play an important role in the selective processes.
But ma'am, is this not similar to the gatekeeping process which happens in media actually?
Yeah, you can claim a similarity, but for the gatekeeping thing which happens in media, what happens actually is there is a particular person who is doing his job of selecting and filtering the messages.
Yes, selecting
and filtering the messages so that he can decide which particular message the public should actually go through. Also, what happens is that here basically the individual plays the role of a gatekeeper.
Okay.
Individual himself, in his mind, as I said, consciously and subconsciously both, he is the one who actually is selecting and interpreting the message.
Okay.
So the selective processes are three in nature. First is the selective exposure, selective retention, and selective perception.
Okay.
These are the three kinds of processes of cognition which an individual can go through.
Okay.
First, we will try to understand what the selective exposure is all about. Okay. Selective exposure basically is the tendency of the people to expose themselves to those messages which are in accordance with their belief system.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
That means a particular message which actually shows their viewpoint, they are going to watch that particular kind of film, or they are going to watch that particular kind of television series or anything, or talk to a particular person who actually, as you know, the communication is all about having a bit of commonality.
Yes, yes.
So here also you're exposing yourself to only those messages where you actually can have some kind of a commonality with your belief system.
Yes, yes.
And here, actually, we have seen that Paul Lazarsfeld, Bernard Berelson and Hazel Goddard, these are the three theorists who had actually conducted a study in US many years back. And there, they have tried to see, you know, in USA, they have these two kind of parties, Republicans and Democrats.
Yes, yes.
So there, there they have seen how media actually exercises propaganda and how actually people who are people who have a particular kind of belief system of about a particular party, they actually watch that kind of media more, which are consonant with their belief system, in the sense that a media which shows something good about a particular party, they will watch that particular channel more.
Okay,
will not watch the other channel. So this has been already proved in the 1940s and 50s by this theories, as I mentioned. So what we see here also, in the Indian perspective also, there are many channels which actually special political interests, if you see. So these channels also, the channels show about a particular party, or this, or they actually try to put forward the notions of a particular party more. So in that case, what happens is that
a niche audience.
Yeah, they have a niche audience, in the sense they have the audience who actually support their beliefs.
Yes.
So they will watch that particular channel more. I'm not naming any channels, but then we know
it is
that
evident, yes,
it is evident.
Pretty much.
Okay. Another way to reduce the kind of dissonance is, after making a decision, is to seek out information that is consonant with the decision.
I see.
Okay.
I see.
So that is also, which is very much related to the selective exposure thing. The selective retention, by the name itself, it shows that it is a process by which people tend to remember only that information which is consistent with their belief system. Any kind of information which is, you know, which is likely to help you in some way, or any kind of information which is consonant with whatever you think about a particular aspect of your personality, maybe that particular information will be something which will be liked by you and which you will grasp. But also, we have to understand that any kind of threatening information also is likely to be remembered, because threatening information actually is something which is going to, you know, in later life, which is going to actually threaten your life in some way. And so it is going to be important, in a sense that it is an important aspect which you have to fight for. Okay, so any kind of threatening information is also something which is likely to be remembered, even when that the crisis has gone by.
Is this some sort of a survival instinct or something?
Yeah, because it's a survival instinct, and because that that particular thing in your life is so has created such kind of a crisis, so you're likely to remember that information also. But apart from that also, whatever value system you have, if you consider in relation to media, then whatever value system you have, you will try to retain only that particular media message which actually is consonant with your value or belief system. Okay, we are very likely to reject the other kind of information. Here we can cite a particular example, which a particular kind of research which was done many years back by in 1945, which is considered now to be a classic, which was done by Gordon Allport and Leo Postman. Okay, they had done a particular kind of research to study how rumor spreads fast. among people. So when they did so, actually they tried to study two combatants. One was a Caucasian male who was grasping a razor in his hand, and there was another African-American male on the other hand. Okay, so now this scene, when people saw that, and when they questioned those people, what happened, these people, when whatever they saw, they, as we know that people are kind of discuss it with other people also. So this discussion, in the end, when these researchers went ahead and asked people what they have seen, the later on we see that it was distorted. Distorted in the sense that the people, most of the people, they said that the razor was in the hands of the African-American male, and he was trying to be a threat to the Caucasian male. Okay. So here you can understand
how is this happening because
what happens is that when you see a particular thing, then when you actually tell about that particular thing to other person, the message, you know, when it travels through so many different individuals, it sometimes gets distorted.
Okay.
And people actually had that particular kind of message which was consonant with their value system. So that was an important thing which actually was proved through this theory, that what was outer becomes inner and what was objective becomes subjective.
Okay.
So what they tried to prove is that people had certain notions, already notions that, you know, that if it's an African, it's a black, violent. This particular notion which was there, they based their thinking on that particular notion.
Okay.
Without even thinking twice, you know, it might be the other way also. So you can understand. So they actually retained only that information. The razor was important, not the particular person who had the razor. This kind of research cannot be done now, but now we have to understand it in a more, you know, specific manner, because we have different kinds of new media channels coming up. So here, biased news, biased opinion also plays an important part in whatever you retain, you retain or not.
Okay.
Selective perception is the mental or psychological recasting of a message so that its meaning is in line with particular person's beliefs and attitudes. That whatever we see or expect to see, we actually interpret an event based on our perceptions. Meaning that one particular event which you have seen and the same event which I have seen, I will interpret it in my own manner. Like, maybe we both belong to the same social category or from the same economic class, but our value system or maybe our socialization process was different. So whatever your interpretation would be of that particular message would be different for me. Even when something is right before our eyes, it is hard to view it without preconceived notions. So we can't be unbiased when we view a particular thing, or particular message, or particular event which happens in front of us. So in this case also, we can cite a particular kind of example, which was a research which was done by Keck and Mueller in 1994, who conducted a study of US Army-based television commercials, and who in their study saw that though some people interpreted the message in the way in which the advertisers wanted, but there were other people also who interpreted the message in totally different way, I must say. So that also happens. Okay, so your perception plays an important role in understanding a particular message, keeping in mind that these processes are not discrete. Now we will come to the conclusion, which is that perception is a very complex kind of process. The perceiver's needs, wants, moods and attitudes and assumptions are something which are very important. In order to study or understand perception, we need to not only stick ourselves to selective processes only, but we need to also deal with other theories which are associated with the psychological understanding of the brain or the psychological understanding of how an individual is going to interpret a particular message. Different kinds of psychologists and cognitive scientists have actually found it difficult to distinguish perception from information processing. So the way information is being processed in the brain, this is something which is very complex in nature, and so it is not very easy to actually make, you know, watertight compartments between each and every aspect of that. Because human behavior and human attitude is something which needs to be studied more in detail, and this is being done by theorists even now. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.